तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै।
Lecture number 35, our ongoing series on mechanical measurements. In this lecture, we will be completing the module 3. What we will be doing today in this lecture is to look at the measurement of stagnation temperature or total temperature, which is useful or involved in high speed flows. When a fluid like air flows at a high velocity, the temperature we would like to measure, there are two temperatures one would like to look at. One is called the static temperature and the other is called the total temperature or the stagnation temperature. So, we will look at the measurement of stagnation temperature by using different types of probes. The second thing we are going to look at is the measurement of bulk mean temperature, which is required when we want to find out how much enthalpy is transmitted by a moving fluid across. For example, if the flow is inside a duct, we would like to find out how much is the enthalpy which is being convected across a section of the duct. So, how to measure the bulk mean temperature? There are one or two different aspects of it. We will try to look at this, and of course, we will round off the treatment with an example of the measurement of bulk mean temperature. So, before we go and take a look at the measurement of stagnation temperature, let us just look at the basic ideas which are involved. So, we are interested in looking at the measurement of the stagnation or total temperature, total. It is also called the stagnation temperature. And let us look at some of the issues in this. If you recall, we have already looked at some of these in some small detail earlier on, but what we are going to do today is to look at in some more detail, greater detail, the measurement of total or stagnation temperature. We can look at the measurement of temperature in terms of the errors in measurement. We have already looked at it earlier, and let us look at it afresh by looking at the total error in temperature which is measured. If you call it E subscript T, this is the total error in the temperature which is measured by a probe. It is made up of several components. The first one is the error due to the velocity of the fluid or velocity related. Then there could be error due to conduction, we will call it EK. So, we will say this conduction error, and thirdly we have the error due to radiation. So, there are three components to the error in the measured temperature. If we want to reduce, for example, if I want to measure the stagnation temperature, the fluid which is flowing at high velocity must be brought to rest or brought to zero velocity isentropically. We are already familiar with this. Okay? If you bring it to rest isentropically, the temperature of the gas or the fluid which is flowing at high velocity will be actually equal to its stagnation temperature. Okay? But as the fluid is brought to rest, the convective heat transfer from the medium to the probe which is inserted inside the flow to measure the temperature, that gets reduced. So when the velocity is brought to zero, by the stagnation process adjacent to the probe, the heat transfer coefficient is going to reduce. When the heat transfer coefficient reduces, it tends to increase the conduction and radiation errors. Therefore, that is the main problem. So, we will generally say that velocity tends to 0, convective heat transfer reduces and both Ek and Er tend to increase. That is the error due to the conduction in the leads of the thermocouple wire, which is the part of the probe which we are going to use to measure the temperature, that is going to become significant. Therefore, if we want to reduce the conduction as well as radiation errors, we have to take suitable action to reduce this. Of course, radiation can be reduced by using a radiation shield, which also we have referred to earlier in some detail. And the conduction error can be reduced by making the wires very thin. However, if you make the wires very thin, the gas which is flowing over the wire or over the probe is going to induce vibrations in the wire, and therefore it is going to be not satisfactory. Therefore, there is some kind of a balance between the strength requirements and the conduction error which we can put up with, which will decide the diameter and the size of the wires, diameter and also the length of the probe wires. As far as radiation is concerned, of course, we can use a shield of low emissivity and possibly high thermal conductivity material. So, the design of a probe for measuring the stagnation temperature requires special consideration, So, what are these special considerations? We will quickly look at them. Suppose we have a flow at high velocity, it may be even supersonic. We have to have an arrangement by which the supersonic stream is brought to rest, and we already know that it is going to give rise to a shock wave across which the pressure will increase and the velocity will decrease from supersonic velocity to subsonic velocity across the shock wave. And after the fluid has passed through the shock wave, it is going to further reduce in speed and comes to stagnation at the near the probe. The probe itself may be in the form of a thin wire, or it could be a thin film. These two ideas we will try to look at both of these. It will be either in the form of thin film or a thin wire, and how to design this is what we are going to take a look at. So, let us look at the typical total temperature or stagnation temperature probe. This is the typical example I have taken from a NASA technical memorandum, March 1993. See, the probe itself, the length from this point to this point here is about 50 millimeters, let us say, something like a very 2 inches or 50 millimeters. So, what we have is, this is a radiation shield, a thin radiation shield, which is having an inlet which is very wide and narrow, as is indicated here. The flow is coming from this side and it probably has passed through a shock wave, and it is decelerating. After going through the shock wave, it is going to enter this duct, which is in the form of an oval cross section. Okay? And it is going to become a circular cylindrical cross section downstream, which is achieved by having a flattening of the duct, as is indicated here. So, this is, the duct is flattened, and so it becomes an oval cross section here. And downstream, I have the R-type thermocouple, which is having a joint between the two thermocouple wires at this point, maybe in the form of butt welding. The bead is formed right here in this place, which is on the axis of the cylinder. And the two thermocouple wires are always, of course, taken out through the back here. And we provide some vent holes on the side. There are two of them, one here and one 180 degrees on the other side of the tube. These vent holes, what they do is, the flow enters the, enters this duct type of arrangement here, and then it comes to stagnation near the probe, and then of course it moves slowly out of the vent holes, because all the medium which comes in must get out. And usually the area ratio, the ratio of the areas of the two vent holes provided to the area of the intake, is about 0.5 to 0.6. It is found to be the most desirable ratio. That means that the vent holes are smaller than the inlet cross section here. What are the things which is going to happen now? Let us look at the basic structure of the flow by looking at what happens, by looking at the flow from one side. So, there is a shock here, which is in the form of a curved shock. It is actually a surface. The flow is coming from here, and the conditions are represented by one, state one. And then across the shock, it undergoes a change of state to state 2, which is the downstream of the shock. And then the subsonic flow actually enters the radiation shield inside. This is the radiation shield part. And the junction is here, and the flow takes place as indicated in the figure. And the flow goes out of the two vent holes on the side. So, it enters from this side, and it, the indicated temperature by the junction is T subscript J. Actually, this temperature which is indicated is not the same as the stagnation temperature, because there is something called the recovery factor. The temperature indicated by the junction is not equal to the temperature of the total temperature of the stagnation temperature. For finding out what is the relationship between the junction temperature and the total temperature, we use experimental data which correlates in the following fashion. We look at what is called the probe recovery factor. It is defined as the temperature indicated minus the temperature of the ambient after the shock wave divided by the temperature, total temperature T subscript T C here minus the temperature after the shock wave. Okay. This ratio is called the recovery temperature, and you can see from the graph which is given here that the recovery factor, which is given by this ratio of the two temperature differences, correlates well with the pressure of the fluid after the shock wave multiplied by junction temperature which is measured raised to the power of minus 1.75. This parameter is called the Winkler parameter, Winkler, Winkler parameter, and it is known that this recovery factor is a function of this parameter PT2 TJ to the power of minus 1.75. Actually, we are measuring TJ. We can also measure the pressure by using a static probe, pressure probe just after the shock wave, so that these two are measurable quantities. And once we know these two quantities, I can find out what is the corresponding value of the recovery factor. And once I know the recovery factor, for example, if it is here, the recovery factor is about 0.95, then this quantity is equal to 0.95. From this, I can find out what is the total temperature. So, the total temperature is measured indirectly by measuring the temperature of the temperature indicated by the probe TJ, then the temperature after the shock wave. The TTC is the temperature which is required, which is now obtained by using the concept of the recovery factor. The recovery factor depends on the nature of the fluid, the Prandtl number and so on. So, we need not go into the details, but essentially it is correlating with this factor, the Winkler parameter as shown here. So, the stagnation temperature is actually measured indirectly, and the other point to notice is that the stagnation temperature remains constant across the shock wave, because the process is essentially adiabatic. There is no heat addition or heat rejection or heat loss. Therefore, the stagnation temperature essentially is the same across the shock wave. Therefore, whatever stagnation temperature you measure after the flow has passed through a shock wave and has gone into the probe, and whatever it indicates is the same stagnation temperature as the stagnation temperature of the parent gas which is upstream of the shock wave. So, this is one type of probe for measurement of stagnation temperature. Let us look at another interesting way of doing it. This is somewhat different in the sense that it involves a little bit of understanding of what is happening near the stagnation zone. Let us look at the probe. The probe itself consists of, this is taken from the paper AIAA 98-3131. It is called a dual film stagnation enthalpy probe. So, essentially what we have is, we have two thin films here. These thin films are actually heat flux gauges. We have already in the previous lectures, we have dealt with thin film heat flux probes or heat flux sensors. So, these two happen to be heat flux sensors which are placed very near the stagnation zone or stagnation point on a suitably shaped body. In this case, you can see the body is in the form of a blob body, and at the front stagnation region, the two films, two film gauges are placed close to each other. They are placed close to each other. And what do? we heat these two films to two different temperatures to start with. So, by passing a current or by placing a heater just behind the thin film gauges, we maintain the, or we bring the temperatures to two different values. So, now suddenly the flow starts at high Mach number and it comes to stagnation near the stagnation point, okay? Just like what happened in the previous case. So, when the at the stagnation point, the heat transfer between the fluid and the film depends on the temperature difference, the stagnation point difference, the stagnation temperature or the total temperature and the sensor temperature, okay? So, the depending on the temperature of the two sensors which are earlier brought to the suitable values, the heat transfer will be proportional to the temperature difference, the temperature difference between the stagnation temperature and the film temperature. So, what is done is actually we measure the heat flux, instantaneous values of the heat flux at the two films. So, Q 1 and Q 2 if we are measuring, we also measure the temperature of these two probes at the same time. So, T 1 and T 2, Q 1 and Q 2, these are the heat fluxes measured and the temperatures measured. Then we can do a simple analysis as indicated here, which says that the heat transfer rates for the two thin films are given by, for the film which is maintained at temperature T 1 or which is whose temperature is T 1 at the time of the measurement. Q 1, the heat flux which is also measured, is equal to some heat transfer coefficient multiplied by the temperature, total temperature minus T 1, and Q 2 is also equal to the same heat transfer coefficient, because the two films are very close to each other, they essentially are exposed to the same kind of environment, and we can assume that the heat transfer coefficient is roughly the same value for the two sensors. So, H into T t minus T 2. So, these T 1, T 2, Q 1 and Q 2 are measured. H of course, we do not know what the value is. We can eliminate H and solve for T subscript T here in terms of Q 1, Q 2, T 1 and T 2, and you can see that the solution gives you the stagnation temperature equal to the temperature of the sensor 1 plus Q 1 into T 2 minus T 1, this is the temperature difference between two sensors, divided by Q 1 minus Q 2. You just notice that T 2 minus T 1 is Q 1 minus Q 2. These are two opposite sides. So, the essentially the method consists of using two heat flux sensors of the thin film type, placing them close to each other near the stagnation point on a bluff body, measuring the two heat fluxes Q 1 and Q 2 and the corresponding temperatures of the sensors T 1 and T 2. Of course, Q 1 and Q 2 should not be same, T 1 and T 2 must be different. That is why we heat them to different temperatures to start with, and then obviously, Q 1 and Q 2 will be different, because the potential difference available for heat transfer is the difference between the stagnation temperature and the sensor temperature. So, sensor temperatures are measured, corresponding heat fluxes are measured using the thin film sensor, and therefore, I can eliminating H, I can solve for the stagnation temperature and obtain the value by a simple process. It is a very useful method. Usually, the high speed tunnels where such experiments are done, the process itself goes for a very short period, and therefore, these methods are ideally suited for that. And also, thin films have very high frequency response, and therefore, they are suitable for measurement of these values. So, we have covered essentially two different ways of doing it. There is a third method which I am going to look at with a little more in a detailed fashion, and this is a fine wire thermocouple probe. So, let us look at the probe and see how it performs. We essentially have a very thin wire thermocouple made up of the tungsten rhenium 5% against tungsten rhenium 26%. The wires are like here and here, and you see that there is a butt weld at here. I have shown it as a bead actually if the bead is very small, it will be the same size as that of the wire itself. So, just to indicate that there is a bead, I have indicated here. So, it is a wet welded thermocouple, and in fact, it is in the stagnation point or stagnation region of the flow which is coming from this side, and therefore, the temperature is indicated by the this thermocouple. So, between these two, I get the thermocouple reading, which is one temperature. Secondly, I am also attaching a reference thermocouple made up of the same thermocouple pair, and it is attached at this point. This is called the reference thermocouple. So, what is the advantage of why do we use this reference thermocouple? I know the cross sectional area of this wire. If I know the temperature which is measured here and the temperature which is indicated by reference thermocouple, I can in fact find out what is the conductive loss. In other words, the error due to conduction through the probe, through the lead wires, can be estimated by using simple conduction analysis from here to here, and therefore, I can find out the conduction error by this method. So, the conduction error can be estimated and subtracted from the or added to the temperature to get the proper value for the temperature. The essentially, the two wires are taken out through, as is shown here, these two are the same material as the thermocouple material, but of larger cross section. These two are of larger cross section. Therefore, this wire forms the this wire pair of wires forms the thermocouple, which is sensing thermocouple. To the end of this, I have attached a reference thermocouple, and these two are taken through here. There is a ceramic sleeve and then a SS tubing through which is taken out, and the probe is mounted on a mount like as is shown here. This is taken from the reference given here. Again, in this case also, we have to worry about the recovery factor or the recovery ratio, the ratio of the temperature indicated to the temperature of the stagnation at the stagnation point, and it is correlated with respect to the Reynolds number of the flow based on the wire diameter and the wire conductivity, the wire diameter and the velocity of the fluid which is flowing across that. So, the data has been gathered from various experiments, and basically the curve, full curve here, is actually a relationship which is used for the calculation. In fact, I have plotted that relationship, which is given in terms of the temperature measured divided by the temperature, stagnation temperature, T 0 probe divided by T 0 after the shock wave. After all, there is a shock wave in front and so on, which is similar to the previous case. It is given by a relationship which is related to the Reynolds number of the flow, and the Reynolds number can be anywhere between 10 and 100, and the recovery ratio is from somewhere between 0.86 and 1, and again the recovery ratio is used to identify the proper stagnation temperature. Having looked at the measurement of stagnation temperature, now let us look at what is called the temperature with the bulk mean temperature, which I will explain in some detail before I come back to this slide. So, let us look at the concept of the bulk temperature. Actually, we would like to look at two things. We will use what is called the mean velocity, and we will say mean temperature or the bulk mean temperature. When a flow is taking place in a duct or a tube, if the cross section may be circular or any other shape, so the flow is taking place like here, and there is a certain velocity profile. So, velocity profile, I am just drawing one cross section, but actually it is a three dimensional view I can show by looking at from one end or the other, and there is a temperature variation across that. So, let us say this is the temperature. So, there is a temperature variation, there is a velocity variation, and let me take a simple example of tube flow in a circular tube to explain the concepts, but then we can generalize it for any shape of the tube or the duct. So, circular tube if I take, I can do the following. I can take the cross section, this is the R, and if I consider a small elemental area, this is the elemental area I am considering. So, this will be small r and this will be dr. Okay. So, let us assume that the velocity is a function only of r, and maybe the function temperature is also a function only of r. That means that it is not a function of theta, it is uniform, it is given at any radius, it is a radial function of radius only. We can now see that if the density is rho, specific heat is Cp, these are the density and specific heat. For the present, we will assume that it is constant. In fact, it can be generalized even when these are not constant. We can see that the enthalpy flux through the elemental area, is obviously given by rho Cp T U dA. Instead of dA, I can write 2 pi r dr. Actually, this is your dA, the area element. Okay. So, I can find out the enthalpy flux through the elemental area as a expression given by rho Cp T U dA, and if I want to calculate the total enthalpy crossing the cross section, total enthalpy flux through the cross section. So, if I just say total here, all I have to do is to integrate it from 0 to r. Okay. The integration is from 0 to r, rho Cp T U 2 pi r dr, and if I assume that rho Cp are constants, this can be taken out of the integral sign. This 2 pi is also a constant, I can simply take it out, and therefore, you can see that I can rewrite it as, so if I assuming that rho Cp are constant, then this enthalpy flux equal to rho Cp, I will take out 2 pi also, I will take it out, this integral 0 to r u t r dr, or I can also write as rho Cp 2 pi integral 0 to r u t dA. dA is the area of that elemental ring. So, you see that to determine the flux of enthalpy crossing the section, I require to perform an integration using the values of the velocity at the, for example, in that ring element, I can take the velocity at the center of that ring and the temperature also at the center of the ring. That means, I have to measure the velocity and the temperature at the center of that ring using a probe, maybe a pitot tube can be used for measuring the velocity, and temperature can be measured by using a small thermocouple probe inserted at that particular place. In practice, let us see what happens. This is as far as the theoretical framework is concerned. I would like to also look at what is called the bulk mean temperature, which is defined as rho Cp, such that bulk mean temperature is defined such that rho Cp into 2 pi into u bar into Tb into area of cross section of the tube gives you the enthalpy flux. I will say enthalpy flux. So, I have introduced an average velocity, I have introduced the bulk temperature. So, if you want to get the bulk temperature, I have to, you can see here, this will be equal to this, and therefore, 2 pi rho Cp can all be cancelled. So, you can see that u bar Tb bar A is equal to integral 0 to r ut dA, and what is u bar? U bar is nothing but the mean velocity. Okay. It can be u bar A, by very definition, is nothing but UdA, and therefore, I am going to get Tb is nothing but integral 0 to r UtdA . This is the final expression we have got. So, what does it mean? It means that to determine how much enthalpy is crossing a section of the tube, I must know the details about how the velocity and the temperature vary across the section of the tube. I must be able to perform this integration and then obtain the value of the bulk temperature. Of course, it is very difficult to do this integration exactly. So, what we do is, we will use what is called an equal area method, and I will briefly describe what this involves. So, we divide the cross section of the flow into equal area elements. Of course, we cannot take too many elements, we will take a certain small number of elements, maybe 5 or 10 at the most, such that this dA is replaced by delta A, which is a constant value. I will show how it is done a little later on in the case of a practical application. So, what we are going to do is divide the flow cross section area into several equal area elements, and in each equal area element, each area element is now delta A, and we have a finite number of them. Finite number may be 5 or 10 or maybe of that order, maybe a little more, okay, or of that order. So, what we will be doing is, we will be replacing the integral, we will be replacing the integral by summation. So, integral replaced by summation. So, what I will be doing is, this integral u t d a is approximately equal to sigma u t delta A, and if I assume delta A are the same for all the elements, so I will say I u I t I delta I A I, but if delta A is constant equal to delta A, then this becomes simply delta A multiplied by sigma I u I t I. very simple expression. Similarly, integral u dA will be approximated by sigma u I multiplied by delta I. So, you see that the bulk temperature now becomes roughly sigma over I u I d I divided by sigma over I u I. This essentially explains how the measurement is made. So, this is basically basic expression which uses an approximation by replacing the integral or integration by a summation. Okay, with this background, I will go back to the slide and explain what is happening. I have taken one or two simple examples. The first example I have taken from the reference which is given here, based on paper presented at Congress of Refrigeration, just to indicate that this kind of a method is used in actual practice. We have a wind tunnel for testing a heat exchanger. Let me briefly explain what is being done here. We have a wind tunnel which provides a more or less uniform flow of air across the cross section of this duct. It is a big duct, and the air is taken from outside through this entrance, which is in the form of what is called a bell mouth, and the flow is taking place from this side. The flow straighteners are going to make sure that the flow is a parallel flow inside this duct, and the duct is usually what is called a short duct. That means that the boundary layers which develop near the boundaries are very, very thin, so that we can assume that, or we can guarantee that the flow velocity is more or less uniform across the cross section. And you actually keep the heat exchanger, which has to be tested, right in the path of the uniform air stream. And of course, you can measure the coolant inlet temperature, outlet temperature for the heat exchanger. And for the air inlet temperature, we use what is called a rake, a set of thermocouples spaced at uniform spacing as shown here. The duct can be in the form of a rectangle or a square, and all you do is to measure the velocity and the temp, when one velocity, because I indicated the velocity is going to be uniform across the section. Therefore, u bar is equal to u in this case, and the temperatures are measured by a rake of thermocouples. A rake is what is shown here, a mini thermocouples spaced in a regular array here, and another set of thermocouples mated here. And what we do is, we measure the bulk temperature at inlet by using that replacing the integral by the summation as I indicated. So, you measure in this case, because the velocity is uniform, the arithmetic mean of the temperatures indicated by the thermocouples is also equal to the bulk temperature. Similarly, at the outlet, because the velocity is more or less uniform, the arithmetic mean of the temperatures indicated by the temperature sensors is the temperature, bulk temperature of the fluid. So, in this example, we are interested in measuring the bulk temperature at entry and exit to find out how much heat transfer has taken place from the heat exchanger to the fluid which is flowing across. So, actually, we are trying to measure the heat transfer, and in order to measure the heat transfer, we have to measure the bulk temperature increase as far as the air is concerned in this particular case. The second example I am going to take uses the equilibrium method which I talked about, and I have a duct which is in the form of a rectangle, and I have divided into equal area elements as indicated here. These dashed lines indicate the boundaries of the equal area elements, and the dots or the circles indicate the location where the velocity as well as the temperature are measured. Simultaneous measurement of velocity and temperature. Of course, if it is not possible, we can measure the temperature at one step, and the second step you can measure the temperature, measure the velocity. You can use a velocity probe like a Pitot tube, and for you can use a temperature probe in the form of a thermocouple. And in fact, what we do is, we use an array of thermocouples, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 4 thermocouples in the form of what is called a rake. And the rake is moved in this direction by stepping it from this position to this position, from there to here, and so on, by having a some arrangement by which it can be moved from position to position. We can measure simultaneously the temperature at this position, in this column, and so on and so on. The theoretical basis is that the temperature velocity measured here is assumed to represent the velocity and the temperature on the average in this particular rectangle, which is taken as the unit cell. This is delta A. Okay. In this case, you can see there are 6 multiplied by 5, 30 area elements. So, you measure 30 temperatures and 30 velocities, and you get the mean temperature by measuring, by taking the summation sigma u I T I from I equal to 1 to 30 divided by sigma u I, where I equal to again from 1 to 30. So, let us look at the way it is accomplished in practice. So, we have a rectangular duct here. The photograph is not very good, but it is sufficiently good to notice what we are doing. We have a thermocouple rake here, which consists of 4 or 5 thermocouples, which are capable of moving by using the traverse. It can move in this direction or in this direction. Of course, in this case, what we do is we position the traverse such that it is in fixed position in the y direction, and we move it along the x axis to get a certain number of columns over which the measurement is taken. Okay. So, by moving this in this particular direction in and out, the rake will measure the temperatures at the nodal values. This is taken from a PhD thesis of one of our research students in IIT Madras. This gives you an idea as to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4 is about 20, array of 20 values. The anemometer is shown here, which is again moved from position to position to measure the velocity variation. So, this anemometer is moved in and out. Of course, we have only one anemometer here, therefore, we move it from one position to another position individually and take the values of velocities. Thermocouple rake measures simultaneously 4 temperatures, and there are 5 columns. So, 20 values of the temperatures are going to be obtained from this experiment. So, the idea is to obtain the from the recorded data, the idea is to obtain the values of the bulk temperature as well as the mean velocity. So, the example 40 I have taken is actually from the experiment conducted in the laboratory, and what we want to do is use the recorded data in the table at the right to estimate the mean velocity and the bulk mean temperature of the medium, which is air in this particular case. Of course, the velocity which were used were quite small. The maximum value is about 3.65 meters, 3.77 meters, 3.8 meters, and the minimum measured about 2.98. The red values are the temperatures which are indicated by the thermocouple, by the rake which is moved from position to position. The blue values are the values of the velocity measured using the velocity probe, which is actually a hot film probe, which is measured from, which is moved from position to position to indicate the velocity. So, what I have done is, I have put the whole thing in the form of a table, and the cell numbers are given like 1.1, 1, 1, 1, 2, etcetera, like in the form of a matrix. You can go here and see 1, 1 will correspond to this, like 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 3, and so on. So, they represent different cells, and the values of the at the center of each cell are put in the form of a table. In this case, I have used Excel to enter the table, enter the numbers. U meter per second, 1, 1 to 2.2, 5, and then 3, 1 to 4, 5. There are, as you can see, there are 20 entries, 20 velocities are measured, as you see here, and 20 corresponding temperatures are measured, as shown here. I must also tell you that the velocity being very small, u meter per second is only about 3 meter per second, the speed of sound in air is roughly 350 meter per second. So, the Mach number is extremely low, and therefore, the temperature which is measured, which is actually the stagnation temperature, because the velocity is very small compared to the velocity of sound, the stagnation temperature and the static temperature, the difference is very small. It is within the measurement error which is expected in the measurement which you are making. Therefore, we are not taking into account the effect of the velocity in the stagnation temperature. That velocity is so small, the stagnation and the static temperatures are very close to each other. So, we need not worry about that. But of course, if you want to do similar studies at high temperatures, high velocities, one may have to take into account the Mach number effect, and therefore, you have to worry about the difference between the stagnation and the total temperature and the static temperature and so on. Here, we have not looked at, we have not taken the difference between the two into account. So, it is easy to look at the calculation now. The area element, if you look at the this duct is 40 centimeters by 40 millimeters by 50 millimeters, 40 millimeters tall and 50 millimeters wide. So, I have taken 10 millimeter by 10 millimeters as the unit cell. Okay? Therefore, you get, as you see here, I have indicated 10 millimeters, this is also 10 millimeters. So, each one is delta A, or the area element is 10 millimeter by 10 millimeter. Because the area element is the same for all the area elements shown here, the area element size does not come into the picture as far as the calculation is concerned. So, to calculate, all you have to do is to measure the velocity and the temperature at the corresponding cell centers, and then find out what is the product of u and t. And if you want to calculate the bulk temperature, all you have to do is to sum the column sum for u multiplied by t, this column sum, sum all the values in the last column, divided by the column sum for the velocities, the second column. So, the column sums themselves can be used for the calculation of the bulk temperature, and you see that the column sums are given by 2581.34 in appropriate unit, it is actually degree Celsius multiplied by meter per second, and the denominator is 68.4, it is nothing but the sum of all the elements in this column. And if you remember, earlier we talked about the use of Excel, you can get this column sum simply by using summation, which was indicated there. So, what I have done is I have taken the column sum at the numerator and the denominator, and by making this ratio, I get the bulk temperature as 37.74 degrees Celsius. In fact, the velocity, if you average the velocity is given in these two, the velocity of the average velocity comes to 3.42 meter per second. Therefore, this particular example, the flow is in a duct of rectangular cross section. The rectangular cross section has been divided into unit cells of 10 millimeter by 10 millimeter, and the velocities and temperatures have been measured at the center of each one of these unit cells. And based on these values and based on the summation replacing the integral, I have been able to measure the bulk temperature as well as the mean velocity for the flow. And this kind of a measurement is somewhat time consuming, because you have to measure so many temperatures, so many velocities and so on, but it is necessary to do that when the velocity and temperatures vary considerably over the cross section of the duct, in this case the rectangular duct. In the case of a circular duct, you need not measure right across the cross section, only across the radius if you measure it is enough, if there is symmetry with respect to angle theta. If the symmetry is not present, it will be necessary to divide the circle also into elements in the same fashion we did here, maybe in the form of sectors, and we have to measure the velocities and temperatures at the center of each one of these small sectoral elements, and then use the same procedure for measuring the bulk velocity as well as the mean velocity. With this, we actually come to a conclusion of module 3, which tried to look at the measurement of heat flux, and then we have also looked at the measurement of mean flow velocity by using various techniques, and then finally we have looked at the measurement of mean temperature or the bulk mean temperature and also the stagnation temperature in the case of high speed flow. In the next lecture, we will start looking at measurement of thermophysical properties and so on, which will be the module 4 in this set of lectures on mechanical measurements. Thank you. Thank you.